welcome to worship. And we pray today that after you experience His presence, after He has the opportunity to speak into your hearts today, that you'll be able to leave and say, "We will never be the same." Thank you for being in worship today. There are a number visiting with us. Brother Jackie's going to be here in just a moment to welcome you. But before he comes, let's take a moment. We'll stand, we'll greet each other, and we'll begin very shortly.
People said, it's a beautiful Lord's Day, Palm Sunday, only 1 week before Easter. We're so glad that you're here, house filled with people. You're going to be blessed as the choir comes in a moment to sing for us. They've been rehearsing, practicing, working for quite a while, and it's always a great time on Sunday morning to hear praises from the choir as they lead us in worship. And like David, I want to welcome those of you who are guests today, and I pray that God will wonderfully bless you for having come this way today. We'll say more about that in a moment, but let's bow our hearts together, shall we? Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity of worship. Thank you for the joy of celebrating the fact that we serve a resurrected Christ. I thank you for the joy and the peace and the forgiveness, the assurance and the hope that is ours in Christ Jesus. And it's our prayer that if there's anybody here today who's not yet discovered the wonderful transformation that Jesus brings, and has not yet discovered the abundant life and everlasting life that comes by repentance of sin and faith in Christ, that today in this service they'll say an eternal yes to Christ. Would you speak to every heart, minister to every need, and most of all, get glory to yourself. Bless the choir as they sing for us shortly. And Lord, today we just want to magnify the name above every name, the name of Jesus. In His name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Would you be seated, please? It is a delight to be able to welcome you this morning, and let me call to your attention something you can do that would be a great help to us. As you'll find in your worship guide, when you open it up, on the far right-hand side is a perforated section where you have the opportunity, first of all, as a guest, to give us your contact information. We're not going to show up at your door unannounced, but we would like to call you or send you a text or an email or a letter, however you prefer, and you can indicate that on there. We'd like to know how we can pray for you, how we can encourage you, how we can minister to you. And our people know that it's also an opportunity for you to let us know in the church office how we can minister to you or as a church family. We're awfully glad today to have all of our guests, but Libby and I are especially glad to have Jamie back with us today. They flew in from Texas yesterday. with me here for today and tonight. And he brought with him Belle and her son, Lorenzo. And we're so delighted to have y'all with us today. We're honored to have y'all. And I want you, as a church family, before the service is over, at the end of the service, you be sure that you find somebody that you've not yet welcomed and welcome them to the service today. Well, Brother David, are you ready? Let's ask God to bless. Let me pray for us one more time. Bless, Lord, our choir. Lord, may they raise their voices to the one who sits upon the throne. And may, Father, we join the angels in saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And this morning we celebrate the fact that we serve a risen Savior and a coming King. And Lord, today we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, on your shoulder. just as surely as we celebrate the power of the resurrection, we also reflect on the cross and we share in the suffering. When Jesus died, he died for my sins and for your sins. His wounds were my wounds, and his pain was my pain. Oh, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering.
Father, forgive them, I heard you faintly say. Still in my heart I feel so guilty. I know the truth is the debt was mine to pay. How could it be right that it happened this way? A fallen and sinful life I was leading. Now why is your body torn and bleeding? It should have been my hands where the nails were. It should have been my feet where the nails were. It should have been my side that was opened, my heart that was broken. It should have been my hands. It should have been my feet where the nails were. At times I am tempted to overlook your grace, thinking I'm worth the love you've given. I walk like I'm earning the right to run the race, somehow forgetting you died in my place. Still isn't long before I've stumbled. One look at the cross and I am humbled. It should have been my
Today, we gather in celebration, hearts full of thanksgiving and praise, and we are here to proclaim Christ is risen. Because of God's great love for us, we have been made alive in Christ. Through his rich mercy, we have been saved, and our souls awakened to his grace.
If love endured that ancient cross, how precious is my Savior's blood. The beauty of heaven wrapped in my shame, the image of love upon death's frame. Having my heart was worth the pain. What joy could you see beyond the grave? If love found my soul worth dying for, a wonderful. Heaven now owns that vacant tomb. How great is the hope that lives in you? The passion that tore through hell like a rose. Oh, the promise that rolled back death in its stone. If freedom is worth the life you raised, oh, where is my sin? Where is my shame? If love paid it all to have my heart, how wonderful, how glorious.
What is it to be loved? To know mercy so full and completely? It is astonishing to think that the Lord of all heaven and earth, who created us, who knew us before we knew ourselves, would look at us with the ultimate affection and say, I will die for you. This is love at its greatest moment.
He took my name.
This Lord's Day, we lift up the name of Jesus. Because of his atoning work on the cross, we can run to him in times of trouble. We call on his name when storms rage around us. We cry out his name when hearts break. We whisper his name in the still of night. And in response, he bids us come. Bring your hurts and cares, your brokenness and confusion, your loneliness and despair. Come, he waits with arms open wide. Remember, the Easter story tells us that though he was dead, now he is risen. He is alive. And he waits for you to come into his loving arms of mercy and grace.
He could have come in all his splendor, greater than the eye has ever seen. He could have come in robes of scarlet, so all the world could see that he was king. He could have ridden on a white horse as a warrior and conquered every land. Oh, yes. But he knew that if redemption's price were paid, it would take a lamb. It took a sacrifices every day. And though the blood appeased to the Father, still the curse of sin was never wiped away. Until one day the rule of justice was halted by a touch from mercy. Mercy's hand, yes. As the Father in compassion said, it's time to send a spotless lamb, spotless lamb.
Take away my sin.
gospel comes in so many forms that God uses, and one of those wonderful ways is through music. And today our choir and our music ministry and all who are involved have shared with us a story that most of us have known for all of our lives. But there is no greater news in all the world than the fact that God sent His Son into the world to die for our sins. And then on that old rugged cross, He bore our sins, and then He was buried in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, He came forth. Paul said to the church at Rome, Jesus is declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. Next Sunday, when we come together to celebrate Easter Sunday, we'll be doing on that one day really what we do every other Sunday of the year. We always celebrate the resurrection when we come together. It's good news. It's good news because everybody needs a Savior, because everybody's a sinner. If there's never been a time in your life when you acknowledge to God in simple childlike faith that you are a sinner, and then turning from that sin, the Bible calls that repentance, and by faith yielding your life to the Lordship of Christ and simple childlike faith, that's called faith. There's never been a time that's happened in your life. I've got good news for you. It can happen today. It can happen here. It can happen now. You never know when God, by His Holy Spirit, will put His finger on your heart and your life, and He'll remind you that this is what's missing in your life, a personal, vibrant, real, meaningful, growing relationship with God by faith in Christ. So I want you to understand this morning, I don't want anybody to leave without knowing for sure that if you were to die today, you'd have a home in heaven. The Bible does say we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. It doesn't mean you're not a good person. It just means you're not good enough. We're not good enough to go to heaven by ourselves. We're not good enough without the precious blood of Christ. But God understands that. So God paid a sin debt for us that we couldn't pay. That's what the cross is all about. As the choir sang so beautifully this morning, that should have been our hands nailed to the cross. It should have been our feet. It should have been our heads crowned with thorns. And Jesus died, Romans says, for us. That word for is the word huper in the Greek, H-U-P-E-R. It means in our stead, in our place. And so you said, Brother Jackie, you mean Jesus died on the cross for me? Absolutely. Why would He do that? Because God so loved the world, even you and me, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then after Jesus did that, and after He rose from the grave, the Holy Spirit put invitations all throughout the Word of God. I'm not sure how many there are. Some have said there are hundreds. And they say things like this, come, for all things are now ready. Or maybe Jesus' word in the Revelation, when He knocked on the door of the church, it said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear My voice and open unto Me, I will come in unto him, dine with him, and he with Me. Or maybe where the Bible says, today is the day, and now is accepted time. Or maybe in Romans chapter 10, where the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And I think the most amazing thing about salvation, about forgiveness of sin, about a home in heaven, about everlasting life, is that it's God's gift, free gift, to all who will receive and all who will believe. Would you bow with me for a moment? For just a brief moment, would you just imagine that it's just us here this morning and the Lord? And would you be so totally honest and transparent as to be totally honest with God about where you are in your relationship with Him? If there's never been a time in your life when you've repented of sin, turned away from sin, and by faith opened up your heart to the Lordship of Christ, trusted Him, asked Him to come into your heart, if you've never done that, why don't you do it today? Why don't you do it here? You do it now. In just a moment, I'm going to lead us in a brief word of prayer. Just repeating these words doesn't save anybody, but it's if you mean them and if they're the words of your heart and they express the desire of your soul. The Bible says the Lord is rich, rich unto all that call upon Him. It'll be a prayer of repentance. It'll be a prayer of faith. And if you're not absolutely sure that if you died today, you'd have a home in heaven, but you'd like to know that, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with me in your heart, but earnestly, silently, but earnestly, with every fiber of your being, claiming that promise, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whether you're a guest, first-time attender, long-time church member, if you've not settled this in your heart, would you settle it now? Heads and hearts are bowed, eyes are closed. Why don't you pray a prayer like this, but mean it with all of your heart. Dear God, just pray it silently. Please forgive me of my sin. Lord, I'm sorry for how I've lived, and I'm sorry for not receiving Christ. I'm sorry for the life that I've lived without your leading in my life. And Lord, right now, I ask you to forgive me. And Lord, wash away my sin through the precious blood of Christ. Lord, I open the door to my heart and I invite you to come in. And I want you to take over my life. And not only wash away my sin and not only give me a heaven, but change me and help me to live for you and to have the joy that you want me to have. And Lord, right now, right here, I ask you, Jesus, come in and save me and forgive me. Make me a child of God. Transform my life. Give me a home in heaven. Make me different. Now the head's bowed and eyes closed. If as best as you knew how, and I know that represents a prayer that even a child could pray. If you just prayed that prayer or something similar and you meant it with all of your heart, I've got good news for you. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you might ask yourself, Pastor, thank God. And you might even want to whisper a prayer of thanksgiving. If you've just prayed that prayer, why don't you just whisper a little prayer silently in your heart? Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. Thank you for coming into my heart. Thank you for saving me. Help me now to live for you. With our heads bowed, may I share with you a first step. a first step that I'd like to ask you to take if you've just prayed that prayer. And that step is, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to open your worship guide, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. And I want you to, while the music is playing, just quietly tear off that perforated section. You can do that now while I'm talking. And on one side of that little piece of the worship guide that's perforated, it says my decision or my next step. And I'd like for you to indicate there, Pastor, I've just prayed to receive Christ, or I've just rededicated my life, or I'd like to become a member of the church, or you may have some other spiritual question. There's a place for you to indicate that right now. And indicate, of course, your name and your contact information. And in a few moments, we're going to give you an opportunity to fold that up. We're not going to have a come down the aisle invitation. We're not going to ask you to stand up and walk down the aisle. But we are going to ask you to take that next step and let us know of your decision so we can contact you and bring you some or send you some discipleship materials to get you started right and hook you up with somebody that will help you to begin to grow in your relationship to Christ. But we need to hear from you. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of the one who gave his life on the cross. If you've just prayed that prayer, or if you still have questions and you're still not sure what it means to be saved, there's a place for you to indicate it there. Pastor, I'm not sure. Please contact me. I need to talk to somebody more about what it means to be saved. And we'll help you. We'll pray with you. We'll get you some materials. Would you do that? Would you do it right now? Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Just about another minute for you to let us know about what may be this morning the most important decision you will have ever made. And maybe you're saved and just have drifted from the Lord. You just want to start over. Just tell us that. Indicate that on that little form and drop it in the offering plate. We want to do all we can to help you to walk in the joy and the fellowship of knowing and serving the Lord. Now, while some of you may be still filling out that form, I'd like for you just to lift your head for a moment and look this way. Scholars tell us that on that Thursday night, before Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, on that evening before the cross, on that Friday morning and the next day, that our Lord gathered his disciples together around the Passover table, and he redefined the Passover when he said, "This is my body. This bread is my body, which is broken for you. And this fruit of the vine, this cup, is my blood, which is shed for you." And he described it as a new covenant in his blood and through his broken body. And then Jesus did something very interesting. He said, "I want you to do this from now on. I want you to observe this memorial meal so that you'll never forget the price that it took to wash away your sins. You'll never take lightly the cross. And you'll always want to simply say, 'Lord, if you love me that much, help me always to live for you.'" If you're saved or seeking to grow in your relationship to the Lord as a believer, want to live for Jesus and know the Lord, this memorial meal is for you. And you're invited to join us this morning as we share together in the Lord's Supper. I'm going to ask our men if they will come, and our deacons will come and prepare with me to serve you as our church family.
Thank you.
it was that evening, our Lord, the Bible says, blessed the bread, and then he broke it. Sometimes we read that without understanding that as he broke the loaf, there's no doubt he understood what that breaking was a picture of. And within hours, by 9 o'clock the next morning, he would be nailed to an old rugged cross. And he took the bread and he gave it to them and said, take and eat. This is my body which is broken for you. And the Lord's Supper had its roots in the Passover. And it was a Passover the Jews observed every year, celebrating that night when in Egypt as slaves. On the houses where the blood was put on the lintels of the doorpost, the death angel passed over, because it was the shedding of blood that saved them. And after that, the Jews celebrated the Passover. And Jesus said, this is a greater than Passover feast. For this is my blood in the New Testament. For without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And with that, Jesus said, drink ye all. Going to conclude their musical this morning. The tomb is empty now. Hallelujah. And praise God.
Tears of yesterday, and I'm weak from climbing mountains that are standing in my way. When my heart is overshadowed by the grief that weighs me down, I remember the tomb is empty now. If my joy sorrow and my victory to loss, if I somehow lose my focus and I can't see past the cross, let my tearful eyes be lifted to that resurrected crown. Oh, hallelujah, the tomb is empty now.
Hallelujah.
shines like a promise through the ages. My Redeemer is alive. Every chain that held me captive lays in pieces on the ground. Hallelujah, the tomb is empty now.
People said, I must confess I have a somewhat awkward moment now. You see, I do not have a clue what we're supposed to say about tonight. And so the personnel committee has assured me they're going to say it for us. You're the man. Good. Somebody said, Brother Jackie, what's going on? So I hadn't got a clue. So Brother David, you're the man.
Here I am. Tonight at 5 o'clock in this very room, we will gather to celebrate the ministry, I almost said the life, but it's not over yet. The ministry of Brother Jackie and Sweet Libby Kay. Would you please come back and join us tonight? We have several folks that will be here with us. Some have worked alongside Jackie. Some have antagonized Jackie through his ministry. Some have just been friends of his. And they would like an opportunity to gather with us, their church family, and celebrate his almost 50 years in the ministry. We're going to meet here at 5 o'clock. The service will start at 5. It will last for an hour or so, and then we're going to go directly across behind us to our Outback building, and we'll have a time of reception and fellowship where you can speak to and love on Jackie and Sweet Libby. I believe Tina's supposed to be here with us tonight. Jamie's going to be singing with the choir like the old times, and he's going to sing by himself, and we're just going to have a great time celebrating their ministry together. I hope you'll make it a priority. You'll come back tonight, 5 o'clock, right here. How about that?
Thank you, dear brother. You did well, just like I told
you. Just like you told me.
Worship through giving is always a very special part of any worship experience. Gemma, would you come, please, and let's prepare to worship our wonderful resurrected Lord through giving. Dave, pray for us.
Let's pray. Father, it's great to be in your house today. Father, we thank you for your presence today because we have been blessed. Father, I thank David and the choir for the work that they've done, this beautiful message of your grace and your love. Father, a love that we are undeserving of, but a love that's so great that you were willing to send your son to die for us. Father, I pray that our response would be to love you more, to live for you, to love others, to be forgiving, Father, and also to give back to you. And Father, I pray that you'll bless this offering today. And Father, I pray as we go out that we will be an example to you in all that we are. In Christ's name I pray, amen.
What a wonderful morning it's been. Thank you for being here, but it would be incomplete, and I would be remiss if we didn't take a moment to say, first of all, choir, instrumentalists, orchestra, sound people, projectionists, all of you who have made this possible. David, thank you from the bottom of my heart, from our hearts, for blessing us and making Easter even more special. Would you give them all one big round of applause, please? Amen. Amen. And choir, just before you finish, lead us in singing our way out. Thank you for singing tonight. It would have been incomplete without you singing tonight. I love you. What a blessing you are to me. Sweet Libby and I are going to be at the back just to tell you we love you. Guests, please come by and let us visit you, shake your hand, and welcome you personally. And now David's going to lead us as we sing our way out. We'll see you at 5 o'clock tonight.
He is here. Closely hear him calling out your name. He is here. You
See you at 5 tonight. Thank you.